5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Broadcasting live from the Solihull Radio Studios, this is the Josh Samuel Show, your Saturday afternoon obsession.
Candles burning, ruby red, sheets are falling off the bed. Run your fingers through my hair. Ask me what you're thinking. Take me there. You hypnotize me with your touch, and I can never get enough of you. It's true. And anywhere you wanna go, my hand is only yours to hold. Oh, you know I'm so obsessed with the way that your lips kiss me like crazy. Ooh, you amaze me when you walk in the room. You got me losing. Yeah, I'm a mess. Girl, I confess, I'm so obsessed. Oh, yeah. Every time you walk away, I guess your perfume likes to stay on my pillow. On my shirt. Listen, baby, for what it's worth, I'm so obsessed with the way that your lips kiss me like crazy. Ooh, you amaze me when you walk in the room. You got me losing it. Yeah, I'm a mess, girl. Give it to me now.
Thought it. Four games in and they've maintained a perfect start to the 18-19 Premier League season. Congratulations of course going to Javi Gracia and his team for their incredible first four results. And to the man himself for picking up August's Manager of the Month award. Anyway, hello, good afternoon, bonjour, j'espère que ça va bien. Welcome to Solihull Radio's first ever broadcast recorded outside of Solihull. But I'm not just outside Solihull. I'm not even just outside England. I'm living it up in the south of France. which is where I'll be for the next 7 months. But anyway, my location has changed, but what hasn't changed is Solihull Radio's only sports show. So thank you for choosing Solihull Radio, and more specifically, the Josh Samuels Show, for your Saturday afternoon entertainment. So sit down, strap in, turn the sound up.
Guess
here we go.
All I'm really trying to say is I'm obsessed, babe.
On this week's show, I'll be reviewing match day 4 of the Premier League, as only 3 teams now remain with a 100% record, whilst West Ham were subjected to their 4th defeat in 4 matches. After the regional roundup, I'll be discussing the recent goings on at Villa, Blues, Coventry, Walsall, West Brom, Wolves, and of course our very own Solihull Moors. I'll be discussing whether being a good player will make you a good captain. Penultimately, I'll be assessing the accuracy of the player ratings from EA Sports' FIFA video games. And finally, I'll be taking a look at the recently revealed team sheet of the most expensive Premier League squad of all time, thanks to inflation. And we've also got the regular features of 60 Second Scoop, that's news to me, Topical Team Sheets, which this week is the Tottenham Hotspur all-time Premier League 11, on this day, and winners and sinners. And as always, there are an almost endless amount of ways you can get in touch with me to tell me your thoughts on all of this afternoon's topics. But unfortunately, you won't get them read out live on air, because I've had to record this one in advance. But you can still send me a text on 075-64-30-30-64, or send me an email at studio@studyhubradio.com. I'll do my very best to read out any comments you make on next week's show. And of course, you can tweet me at Samuels Radio, or you can use the hashtag The Josh Samuels Show or The JS Show. Right, showtime. As always, we'll be kicking off with the 60 Second Scoop. On Saturday, Liverpool and Chelsea maintained their 100% starts to the season with victories over Leicester and Bournemouth, whilst West Ham remained rooted to the bottom of the table after a last-gasp defeat to Wolves. On Sunday, Cardiff and Arsenal entertained as the Gunners ran out 3-2 winners, and Watford stunned Spurs as they beat them 2-1 to make it 4 wins out of 4. Liverpool captain Jordan Henderson signed a new 5-year contract on Monday, stating there's no place he'd rather be. On Tuesday, it was revealed that Crystal Palace's ladies team have been told that they have to secure their own £250 subscription fee if they want to continue playing, just weeks after men's player Wilfried Zaha was handed a new £130,000 a week contract. On Wednesday, David Beckham revealed the name of his brand new MLS franchise as Inter Miami was introduced to America. The UEFA Nations League finally kicked off on Thursday as world champions France were held by their predecessors Germany to a 0-0 draw, whilst Wales eased past Ireland 4-1. And yesterday saw Belgium decimate Scotland 4-0 in a friendly at Hampden Park. And that was this week's 60 Second Scoop. Moving on now with a bit of Andy Grammer as we review last week's Premier League action, with You Should Know Better Than That.
I'm on the phone, you turn your back on me and we're all alone. Why is this happening? I never thought I would be questioning the one I love. But here we are, wrapped up in silence. Can we sound the alarm? Both so defiant and don't know where to start. So hard for me to stay. You should know better than that. Before you go on breaking my heart and I fall even deeper in love and my lungs screaming out, can you hear me? You should know better than that.
You Should Know Better Than That by Andy Grammer, and I'll reveal all about why that's relevant to our Premier League review, kicking off as always with last Saturday's games, and going chronologically, we're going to kick off with Leicester against Liverpool, with the Reds beating the Foxes 2-1 at the King Power Stadium. Sadio Mane put the Reds 1-0 up after 10 minutes, before Roberto Firmino doubled their lead on the stroke of half-time, before an absolute horror of a blunder by a new goalkeeper, Alisson, led to Rashid Ghazal getting a goal back for Leicester on 63 minutes, but it wasn't enough. But Liverpool just managed to hold on to those 3 points there. So what can both sides take from that game? So certainly as far as Leicester are concerned, yeah, encouraging in places. It was good that they managed to get a goal against the table toppers, aren't they now? And I think they have been pretty much since the beginning of the season, if not since the beginning of the season. As for Liverpool, well, yeah, I guess the good and bad places, really. Of course, you can't ever complain about winning a game. But questions have to be asked of their goalkeeper, Alisson. And yes, Jurgen Klopp has said, oh, it's good that he's got his mistake out of the way during the beginning of his time here. But come on. Realistically, they're the kind of mistakes that meant that he shipped out Loris Karius to Besiktas for a two-year loan. I mean, the keeper's so bad, no one wants to even buy him. And now he's replaced a keeper for, not a small amount of money to do realistically the same errors. And in many ways, Liverpool were lucky that it was only the one that Leicester ended up scoring. If it was a game against a more lethal side, let's just say Liverpool had been playing Watford, I have a feeling Watford would have continued to punish Liverpool for the stupid mistakes. Because I don't think it was just the isolated incident with Alisson. And how much longer will Liverpool be able to get away with winning despite these errors? I suspect they're going to get caught up. Then we had Brighton against Fulham in the first of the 3 o'clock kickoffs. The away side taking the lead thanks to goals from Andre Schürrle and Aleksandar Mitrovic. And then 5 minutes after Mitrovic's goal, Murray scored his first before his second, the equaliser, a penalty 6 minutes from time. So all in all, decent result really for both sides. You know, a point apiece. They can't really have too many complaints about that, I wouldn't have thought. Fulham, of course, just coming up, so they'll be looking to just get as many points as they can, really. Brighton had a decent start, of course, beating Manchester United, then losing to Liverpool in their opening 3 games. I think they'll be encouraged by taking a point against Fulham. Fulham being one of the strongest promoted sides that we've seen in a long time, I reckon. So I would say that for a newly promoted side, the point is good for Fulham. And for Brighton's cause, it doesn't do them any harm either. So not too much to report about that, really. A very entertaining match, nonetheless. But yeah, that's a Brighton 2, Fulham 2. Moving on now to Chelsea, who beat Bournemouth 2-0 at Stamford Bridge. Goals through Pedro and Eden Hazard. Again, much like with the previous game, there's not too much to report. It's probably an expected result, really. I'm pretty sure that's the score I predicted, actually. So quite conservative, not too exciting, quite laid back, I guess. Bournemouth, they went for it. They were aggressive. They were charging. They were trying to close down the Chelsea attack, but eventually they got worn down, didn't they? They got worn down, and Chelsea managed to get a couple of goals in the final 20 minutes. And some might say they got a bit lucky. In my opinion, Chelsea did what they needed to. They didn't make any mistakes. I wouldn't quite say that this is Sarri ball. You know, some commentators are saying, oh yeah, we're finally seeing Sarri ball because Chelsea winning matches. I'm not convinced by that, but he's got them winning nonetheless, so we can't have too many complaints about that. Crystal Palace versus Southampton. So Southampton winning 2-0 there, thanks to goals through Danny Ings and Pierre-Emile Højbjerg 2 minutes into stoppage time for their first win of the Premier League season. Crystal Palace, their poor start to the season, I'm sure, has shocked many, me included. After Roy Hodgson took over, I think it was something like, was it 4 games into last season? I thought, okay, we can, if they had played in those 4 games as they played throughout the rest of last season, I think they'd have had an even better finish than they did last season. So I was expecting them to be firing off all cylinders and knocking teams like Southampton away, teams that they really should be beating. So it was quite surprising to see Crystal Palace slip up at home. Danny Ings somehow has managed to find his scoring form again. And that's, I think, is it his second goal in 2 games? Something like that. So yeah, not a bad signing after all. Graham Marchese clearly doing something right. Well, I'll say something. He's got their first win in four games. But even so, I think in the end, it may actually be the case that that's a more of an anomalous result, and Southampton will probably still find themselves struggling towards the bottom of the Premier League table. Crystal Palace, I still imagine they're destined for somewhere around 12th or 13th come the end of the season. Huddersfield and Everton at Goodison Park ended in a 1-1 draw, with two goals occurring in only 2 minutes. Philip Billing putting the Terriers in front after 34 minutes, and Dominic Calvert-Lewin getting the equaliser just 2 minutes later. So Everton, I think, will be quite disappointed with only getting a point from Huddersfield. They've had a great start to the season under Marco Silva. Richarlison, yes, he was missing, and yes, he'd been their talisman in the first couple of games. Even so, they've maintained an unbeaten start to the season. But great performance by Kurt Zouma. I'm really quite surprised why Chelsea have loaned him out again, to be honest with you. He had a decent season last season with Stoke. Yes, they got relegated, but still a great player. And I suspect if he continues like this, Chelsea may be forced to sell him, because I think they're going to get some good offers for him. But yeah, so Everton won, Huddersfield won. Right, now to the game which Andy Grammer's song, You Should Know Better Than That, applies to, which is West Ham United 0, Wolverhampton Wanderers 1. And Wolves getting an excruciating late winner there through Traore 3 minutes into stoppage time. But the big talking point has to be Manuel Pellegrini's future at West Ham United. Now, of course, as I've said in recent weeks, a manager's future should not be decided in just 4 games or 4 weeks or even 4 months, really. I think you need to give them at least a couple of seasons to try and implement their philosophy. However, with the current football climate and with the manner in which West Ham's owners, David Gold and Sullivan, like to have this hire and fire mentality, less so with Stavran Bilic, because he was quite successful, but certainly we saw that with David Moyes. Quite why they let him go, I don't know. But West Ham's owners are not afraid to make a change as and when they see fit. So, bearing that in mind, bearing that West Ham have now lost 4 out of 4, and they're at bottom of the table, rooted to the bottom of the table, with the only team not to get any points so far this season, provided this continues, you have to really fear for the poor guy's job. And I say poor guy, he should never have been given the job in the first place. Yeah, I'm not going to repeat myself every week, but I have to say, Premier League winning manager disuse his ability, really. And if he were that good, with the players that he brought in and the amount of money he had at his disposal, you'd think that he would bring a lot better, or if just slightly better, than no points out of a possible 12. So I imagine that the West Ham board will be closely reviewing Pellegrini's future in the coming weeks and months. And don't be surprised if he isn't there this time next year. Obviously, results permitting. In terms of Wolves, great result for them, of course. Their first victory of the season, having taken a point off Man City the season before last. So, currently finding themselves in 11th, only a point behind Manchester United. So they're not doing too badly at all, are they, really? And you have to feel that Wolves really are going in the right direction. Yes, West Ham are amongst all the 20 teams in the Premier League the most out of form. But even so, it has to be said that Wolves are really looking like they're going to be establishing themselves as a Premier League side for the long haul. And rightly so, because yes, people might say they've bought their way into the Premier League. Yes, people might say they've bought their way into edging into the top half of the Premier League table. But it doesn't always work. Look at QPR, for example. QPR tried to buy their way. I think Tony Fernandez ended up investing in about 2 squads worth of players in 2 years. So, and look what happened. They ended up going down in 2013. Serves them right for letting Man City beat them. But even so, it's all about being managed well from the top with the owners, with the manager Nuno Espirito Santo, and of course the players who are putting in the performances of their lives. And I don't think there's a fan in the land, apart from perhaps their local rivals, that doesn't want to see Wolves do well this season, because it's just a remarkable story. And I wouldn't be surprised if they managed to get into Europe within the next couple of years. I think they're that good. And finally, in Saturday's games, we had the late kickoff with Man City beating Newcastle 2-1 at the Etihad. So Raheem Sterling putting them in front after 8 minutes, DeAndre Yedlin equalising for Newcastle on half an hour, and Kyle Walker grabbing the winner there 7 minutes after the break. So again, much like with Chelsea, conservative win, probably the defence, like last season, is the biggest sticking point in terms of their progress. I think every manager will tell you that you always want to improve on last season. That isn't something I believe City have done this season, which is improve on their squad. And I mentioned when I went to see the Charity Shield that Riyad Mahrez looked a bit dodgy, and he looked like maybe he'd peaked. He'd peaked in 2015-16 with Leicester. But I'm just curious as to why City felt the need to invest, was it 60 million in buying him, when they really should have invested in my opinion, stronger defenders. Vincent Kompany, of course, on his way out in the next couple of years, you would imagine. Not only came off, I think, 1 minute from time, but even so, I think that Man City's focus should have been on strengthening their weaknesses, and it goes without saying, but I think that signing Riyad Mahrez, who played in the same position as a couple of other regulars for City, I was slightly perplexed by the signing, and he's proving my doubts. He's proven why I doubted him, because there has been nothing, to my mind, from what I've seen of him this season, that has convinced me that he is worthy of playing for the Premier League champions. And I feel like Guardiola has to play him, or he feels like he has to play him, because they've spent so much money on him. And yeah, I can see that logic, but shouldn't have bought him in the first place. But yeah, I'm still not totally convinced by Laporte. Yes, Benjamin Mendy's done a great job so far this season. Kyle Walker, I think, is fantastic. But there's something not quite right with that City defence. And I think they are going to start a bit like they did against Wolves. They're going to start conceding some stupid goals, certainly when they start coming against the stronger teams. But that's my brief, for want of a better word, analysis about last week's, or certainly last Saturday's, Premier League action. Moving on now to That's News to Me, but not before we've heard from our sponsors.
Fed up with condensation every morning and hate that yucky mold patch in the bathroom? It's time to contact EnviroVent. They've helped tackle mold and condensation dampness in over a million homes, just like yours. To find out more and to book a free home survey, visit EnviroVent.com, because air matters.
SolihullRadio.com.
Stagecoach Solihull teaches skills
in drama, singing and dance.
But these skills don't just vanish when the curtain falls.
They're skills for life, stretching imaginations and improving literacy.
For a career in the arts,
learning new skills,
or just having fun.
So visit our website,
www.stagecoach.co.uk/Solihull.
Stagecoach Solihull, skills for the arts.
Skills for life.
Yeah!
The Fireplace and Stove Centre, 1204 Stratford Road, Hall Green. Specialists in wood-burning stoves, gas and electric fires, with over 50 live displays in the showroom. Come in and experience your new fireplace solutions. Call 0121 777 8585 for more details.
You're listening to Solihull Radio.
Indian Dream on Dubhouse Parade, Solihull's premier family-run restaurant offering authentic Indian and Bangladeshi cuisine. With fresh ingredients and creative chefs, they can provide bespoke dining experiences, eat in or take away. 0121 704 9058.
Sylvain Distan holds the record for most Premier League appearances without earning an international cap. The Frenchman appeared in England's top flight for Newcastle, Man City, Portsmouth, Everton and Bournemouth, but was never called up by Nibbler, and even joked on Twitter back in 2014 that he was going to make himself henceforth unavailable for international selection. Kevin Nolan, meanwhile, holds a similar record, but exclusively for England, as despite racking up 432 Premier League appearances, he never featured for the Three Lions. Last season saw Gainsborough Trinity, then of the National League North in England's sixth tier, relegated for the first time in their 145-year history, stretching all the way back to 1873. They've also never been promoted. Now, here's a fun fact for all you Globetrotters out there. Tony Cascarino was born in England with an Italian surname, played in France and Scotland, and used to hold the appearance record for the Republic of Ireland, despite later finding out he wasn't actually eligible to have represented them. And here's what I can enjoy, being a St Andrews student. On the 1st of November 2010, Dundee were given a 25-point deduction after going into administration, leaving them bottom of the Scottish First Division table with minus 11 points, 20 behind the team above. However, and miraculously, they then proceeded to go on a 23-match unbeaten run, avoiding relegation and finishing in the mid-table position of 6th. In 1993, former Manchester United winger Mickey Thomas was sentenced to 18 months in prison after he became involved in a counterfeit currency scam during his second spell with Wrexham. Now finding work as an after-dinner speaker, he often uses the brilliant line, "Wayne Rooney's on 100 grand a week." Mind you, so was I until the police found my printing machine. Gary Lineker was given the middle name Winston because he was born on the 30th of November, the same date as Sir Winston Churchill. And similarly, despite going on to become a West Ham legend and even making 124 league appearances for Fulham, Bobby Moore was born with the middle name Chelsea, since, apparently, his family were huge supporters of the Stamford Bridge club. The 1992-93 season is best remembered for being the Premier League's inaugural campaign, but it also saw a couple of remarkable feats in the domestic cups, as Arsenal and Sheffield Wednesday met in both the League Cup and FA Cup finals, with the Gunners winning both, thus becoming the first team to win both in the same season. And finally, Gareth Barry, Rory Delap, James Milner and Gary Speed are the only four players to reach 100 Premier League appearances with three clubs, with Milner achieving the feat during Liverpool's 2-1 defeat of Leicester last weekend. Now, as always, I try and get a song that loosely relates to the facts I've just been telling you all, so here's Lawson with You'll Never Know.
You'll never touch my face, we'll never play these games, we'll never be the same. I think about that night you never said goodbye, you only walked away. It's like my heart stopped beating when you walked away, and all that I believed in is going to end. You up because it hurt too much. Oh, I regret that day. I never dared to ask if you would take me back. Scared of what you'd say. Because my heart stopped beating when you walked away. And all that I believed in is going to waste.
On your side, and leave you thinking of me. I don't
Just South of Heaven there by Blake Shelton, which I'll be using as my springboard to chat about Watford and their remarkable start to this Premier League season with their win against Spurs in a few moments' time. But we are going to kick off with the first of Sunday's games, which is Cardiff City against Arsenal, the Gunners winning 3-2, thanks to an 11-minute goal from Shkodran Mustafi. Cardiff then equalised on the stroke of half-time thanks to Victor Camarasa. Then Aubameyang put the Gunners back in front on 62 minutes. Danny Ward equalised again 8 minutes later. And then 9 minutes from time, Alexandre Lacazette got the winner. So, again, Remy Gard's not exactly demonstrating why he's held in such a high regard by so many pundits and I suppose the Arsenal owners as well. Arsenal should, you know, for a team of Arsenal's calibre, for the amount of money that Arsenal have at their disposal, for the quality of the players and the theoretical quality of the manager, again, not something that I particularly rate, but even so, they should not be conceding two goals to Cardiff, who have barely managed to score in their other three games against significantly weaker opposition. So, I suppose you have to go back to the potential suggestion that Arsenal, that Unai Emery isn't that great defensively. Of course, we know that thanks to his time at PSG, but I'm not going to go into that too much. So, obviously, a lot of work there to do on the training ground. But on the other end of the pitch, we had an absolute scorcher from Alexandre Lacazette, didn't we, to get the winner. And I think he even set up Aubameyang's goal. So certainly offensively, Arsenal going in the right direction. But defensively, perhaps still a lot to be desired. So plenty for Unai Emery to think about. Got a couple of weeks before their next game. So certainly, I would say Arsenal might have cause to be slightly concerned. I know that sounds like a really wishy-washy conclusion. But yes, they got the win, which is, of course, a positive. But they still conceded two goals against one of the weakest teams in the league. So, and also a team that's struggled to score all season. So, again, how do you weigh the pros and cons of that? I guess Emery will be happy because he's got the win. But even so, I think there's slight cause for concern in the weeks to come. Over to my team now, Manchester United, who beat Burnley at Turf Moor 2-0. Despite Romelu Lukaku's brace, the big talking point was Marcus Rashford. Now, I know that it's been slightly contentious as to whether he should have been sent off. Perhaps slightly provoked by Phil Bardsley and the whole incident in itself. But it was still a stupid thing to do, wasn't it? Headbutting someone. You know it's wrong. It's not a bad tackle. It's not accidentally handballing it. It's deliberately going out of your way to headbutt someone. So, I can't help but feel that it was deserved a red card. And I don't like to say that because obviously United fan Rashford is one, I do think he's actually one of our best players. But if you do something stupid like that, you deserve to be punished for it. And it was just a ridiculous incident. And he admitted after the game that he lost his cool for a split second and that's what set him off. But when you play at the high level, at the highest level rather, and you're playing for one of the best teams in the world and, you know, the most expensive, the most valuable team in sport in the world, you can't afford to be making mistakes like that, I'm afraid. So I do think there has to be some disciplinary reaction, because when you represent the club and such a big club in that way, more is expected of you. So disappointing. With Lukaku, great brace. Much like with Chelsea, conservative 2-0 win. Performance-wise, not too much to write home about. Burnley have been shocking all season. They went out of the Europa League a couple of weeks ago. Perhaps still deflated, perhaps still fatigued from that. But I don't think Jose Mourinho's relaxed about that win. I think it's a game he was expecting to win, and probably with a 2-0 result. So not a massive amount of excitement, really, coming from that game at Turf Moor. And finally, Watford, who, as I said a few moments ago, are probably just south of heaven as we speak. 4 wins out of 4, a remarkable start to the Premier League season. Now, a lot of people have been comparing them to the title winners Leicester City from 2015-16. I'm not so sure that Watford will go on to do it, because I just think that we're in a slightly different era of the Premier League now to where we were 3 years ago. And the reason I say that is because Chelsea, who had won the league before, the season before Leicester, fell apart. Jose Mourinho fell apart. That's obviously title defence gone. Man City in a state of repair, in a state of transition, I suppose. So they were miles away from where they should have been. Then there was Manchester United, who under LVG, well, the less said about his spell, the better, I personally think. And Tottenham, who are the only club in world football who could finish third in a two-horse race. So compare that to Watford now. We've got Man City, who, again, I'm going to say I don't rate them, but they still, regardless, were the best team of a very bad bunch, won the league with record points, record gap. So it's a completely different climate. Yes, they may have dropped points against Wolves, but they're still going to be up there come the end of the season. Tottenham are, apart from, of course, the fact that Watford beat them, but Tottenham still are playing amazing football. They absolutely humiliated United week before last. Arsenal, okay, maybe not doing much. Chelsea certainly looking rejuvenated under Maurizio Sarri. And Liverpool, probably the favourites for the title at this moment in time, much as it pains me to say it. So there are far bigger teams and far more powerful teams that are fighting to win that Premier League title, as opposed to when Leicester won it, where I don't want to discredit them by saying they were the best of a bad bunch, but they were. They ultimately, if the rest of the teams had been at full strength, Leicester wouldn't have had a chance. And I do think that many of the challenges are at full strength this moment in time. So, that being said, I would still like to see Watford get maybe a top seven finish. I still think the Europa League is definitely within their grasp. Javi Gracia, of course, winning manager of the month. Not that I suggested that at all. Anyway, and the thing is, they don't show any signs of slowing down, really, do they? I mean, beating Tottenham, one of the league's best teams. Well, that's a match they certainly weren't expecting to win, home or away. So, definitely, if they were looking at where they'd be getting points throughout the season, that's certainly 3 points gained, I would imagine. So, all looking good as far as Watford are concerned, sitting in third place, and their fans will be dreaming of those yellow and black ribbons on the Premier League trophy come the end of the season. And it would be great to see. I have to admit, I just don't think it's going to happen. I just can't see it, I'm afraid. Sorry, Hornets fans, I just don't see it. But anyway, that's round off of all of last week's Premier League action. Coming up now, we go back in history with On This Day. On the 8th of September 1888, the first 5 matches in the Football League were played. Around 25,000 were in attendance, as 23 goals were scored in all. And on that same day in 2015, Wayne Rooney became England's all-time record goalscorer after scoring a penalty in the 2-0 defeat of Switzerland at Wembley. On the 9th of September 1998, the Premier League saw one of its most remarkable ever matches as West Ham hosted Wimbledon. The Hammers found themselves 3-0 up after half an hour, with one from John Hartson and a brace from Ian Wright, before the Dons pulled the goal back before half-time. With 15 minutes remaining, it was 3-all, before Efan Ekoku netted the winner for the visitors with only minutes to spare. On the 10th of September 1960, the first ever live broadcast of an English League game aired, as Blackpool took on Bolton in a repeat of the famous 1953 FA Cup final. Star player Stanley Matthews was absent through injury, and the match received dire TV ratings. In fact, they were so dire that Arsenal and Spurs refused for their matches in the weeks that were to follow to be televised, and the British public would have to wait another 23 years before another live league match would be broadcast. On the 11th of September 1895, the first FA Cup trophy, known as the Little Tin Idol, and cost around £20, was stolen from the shop window of a Birmingham boot and shoe manufacturer, William Shilcock. The cup had been lent by cupholders Aston Villa, who were later fined £25 by the FA to pay for a replacement trophy, and the Little Tin Idol was never recovered. On the 12th of September 1885, in a Scottish Cup first round match, Dundee Harp beat Aberdeen Rovers 35-0, surely a record that would last forever. But, amazingly, 20 miles away on that same day, in the same competition, Arbroath beat Bonacord 36-0 to record what is still the highest score ever in a senior football match in Britain. And on that same day in 1974, a sensation at Elland Road, with Leeds United sacking manager Brian Clough after just 44 days in charge. Defending league champion Leeds had taken just 4 points from their first 6 league matches of the new season. Spanish international Marco Asensio missed Real Madrid's first Champions League match of the 2017-18 season because of a leg injury. He had gone on to shave his legs with a dirty razor, and a hair follicle on his leg became infected, causing a spot, and so he couldn't pull one of his socks up. Yeah. And finally, on the 14th of September 1955, the first double-figure scoreline was recorded in the Football League, as the Invincibles of Preston North End beat Stoke 10-0 on their way to retaining the league title. The Georgia line, as always, introducing the regional roundup with Round Here. So, kicking off as always with our very own Solihull Moors, who have dropped two places into eighth. Last Saturday, they beat Barrow away from home, which was, by all accounts, an incredible game, with three goals in the last 6 minutes. Luke Maxwell putting them in front on the 84th minute, Adi Youssef doubling their lead for his fourth goal of the season 5 minutes later, before Tyler Smith pulled the goal back for the home side in stoppage time. But it wasn't all good news, as on Tuesday they were absolutely thrashed by Leighton Orient 3-0 with Charlie Lee, Macaulay Bond and Matt Harold's goals sealing the victory for the O's. And Jamie Reckford also got sent off for the Moors on 56 minutes. Currently they are hosting Hartlepool United, and obviously being a pre-recorded episode, I can't tell you how they're getting on. But they are away next Saturday to Dover Athletic, so hopefully 6 points there from those games for the Moors. Moving up into the Championship now with Aston Villa, who are down to 12th after they were humiliated by Sheffield United. Jack O'Connell's header put the Blades 1-0 up on 6 minutes, Mark Duffy doubling the lead on 23 minutes, Oliver Norwood getting the third 4 minutes before half-time, before Billy Sharp got the fourth 4 minutes after the break, and Anwar Alghazi's goal on 61 minutes couldn't kickstart a rescue attempt for Villa, and they are, as I said, down to 12th. Steve Bruce certainly having more and more pressure applied upon him by his players. And they're not playing today because of the international break, but they are back in action next Saturday as they're away to Blackburn Rovers, which is live on Sky Sports from 5:30. Moving across Birmingham to Birmingham City, who drew 0-0 with QPR, leaving them in 20th. Also not in action today because of the international break, and they are hosting West Brom in a West Midlands derby on Friday, which is at 7:45, also live on Sky Sports. Coventry City down 3 places to 19th after losing 1-0 to Rochdale, with Calvin Andrew getting the away side the point with his goal just after half-time. And they are in league action this weekend as they are away to Oxford United tomorrow, and they're also playing in the Checker Trade Trophy, hosting Arsenal's under-21s in the South Group E. And next Saturday they host Barnsley. Staying in League One, moving up into the table however with Walsall, who are in 5th. After stumbling to their second draw of the season in a goalless tie at home to Blackpool. And they're currently playing away at Barnsley, and they host Doncaster Rovers next Saturday. West Bromwich Albion, so they won the battle of the relegated sides as they sought off Stoke to lift them up to 9th in the table. Dwight Gale's brace on 16 and 59 minutes was just about enough to overcome Stoke's last-ditch effort through Eric Peters 5 minutes into stoppage time. And they're not in action this week either due to the international break. And as I said, they're away to Birmingham on Friday at 7:45. So you have had some words, as always, from our Baggies correspondent, Tony O'Hagan. He kicks off by saying, delighted to see the Baggies in the hat for the next round of the League Cup and the return of Uncle Roy Hodgson to the Hawthorns with his Crystal Palace side. It got even better on Saturday with the 2-1 win over Stoke, who were pre-season favourites for promotion. Dwight Gale's goals are worth a view on YouTube and once again proves that we got the better deal with our swap of Rondon to Newcastle. Next up, our first local derby against Birmingham City on the 14th of September. It'll be tough, but a win at St Andrews will put us in a very healthy position in the league. Thank you very much, Tony O'Hagan, for those comments. And finally, as always, Wolverhampton Wanderers, who got their first win of the season in the Premier League, leaving it late to take the 3 points from the London Stadium as substitute Adam Traoré subjected Manuel Pellegrini to his fourth defeat in his first four games as Hammers boss, and that leaves Wolves in 11th with 5 points out of a possible 12. And likewise, they are also not playing this week thanks to the international break, but they're back in Premier League action next Sunday at 1:30 as they host Burnley. And that's it for the regional roundup. So now it's time for this week's topical team sheet, which this week is the Tottenham Hotspur all-time Premier League 11. Now, if anyone saw my social media about 24 hours ago, then you'd have seen that I posted my picks, as I always do, in advance of the show. We have had a few comments on my picks, and I'll read those out, as always, at the end of this segment. So kicking off, so I've gone for a 3-4-3 formation, and kicking us off is going to be the goalkeeper, Hugo Lloris, who doesn't really beat off that much competition if you think about it. I mean, Ian Walker, Casey Keller, Paul Robinson, an ageing Brad Friedel. I think there's only ever going to be one pick, isn't there, really? So Hugo Lloris there in goal. Back three, Sol Campbell, first of all. North London's very own Judas, of course. I mean, say what you like about him, and many people do, but he was a fantastic servant and captain for Spurs. And, you know, I would say it was at White Hart Lane that he really established himself as one of England's best centre-backs. So, yes, I agree that if it's a case of being a nice person, and let's not forget he's the same guy that thinks he didn't become England captain because he was black at Rio Ferdinand. I think that as a player, I think he was solid at the back and without question one of Spurs' best defenders in the Premier League era. Rivaled, of course, by Gary Mabbutt, who is our second defender. Perhaps one of their most legendary ever players, he spent 16 years at the club, racking up 477 appearances in the league, was an FA Cup winning captain in 1991, and to be quite frankly honest, I can't see there being many legendary Spurs sides that wouldn't feature Gary Mabbutt. Just a class act, really. Joining those two at the back, Ledley King, the fourth captain to feature so far in this topical team sheet. Perhaps now most fondly remembered for scoring the Premier League's fastest ever goal, King was still classed in defence, and I think we can get away from the fact that in his prime, there probably weren't that many better than him, certainly in terms of Englishmen. I mean, we had, you know, John Terry, Rio Ferdinand and the like, but I guess if you talk about the next rung, Ledley King was great. And a lot of Spurs fans, and certainly the ones that I know, think of him very fondly, and he certainly cemented his place in Spurs folklore during his 13 years at White Hart Lane. In right midfield, they've gone for David Ginola, the French maestro, and I know that many were upset by his omission in the Newcastle topical team sheet last week, but it just so happens that I would say he's deserving of a place in the Spurs one, and he was named PFA Player of the Year in Manchester United's treble winning season, which, in my opinion, is all you need to know about the impact that he had as a Lily White. In the middle of the park, I've gone for Darren Anderson and Luka Modric, the former arguably the most contentious of the 11 to feature in this team sheet, but in my opinion, one of the most deserving. He spent 12 years, probably I'd say, at the top of his game in the centre of that midfield throughout the 90s and early 2000s, and his link-up play with Teddy Sheringham went on to become one of their most lethal attacking partnerships ever. Luka Modric, meanwhile, perhaps less of a club legend, but still provided a top-draw service nonetheless, and he was a key component in the remarkable couple of seasons when they got into the Champions League and then reached the quarterfinals. Which leads me nicely on to the left midfielder, Gareth Bale, potentially the most talented player to ever pull on a Spurs shirt in the Premier League, or maybe even ever, with his hat-trick against Inter Milan in the Champions League group stages catapulting him into superstardom, which saw him score screamer after screamer. And of course then he sealed his world record-breaking move to Real Madrid in 2013, and you know, the rest really is history. Was it four CL titles he's got now? Something crazy like that. Now we've got a forward three. First of all, Robbie Keane, the Premier League's 14th top goal scorer of all time. And I think it's safe to say that his finishing ability was almost, not quite almost, as classed as his routine celebration. And I'm sure there are some of you out there who, at one point, may have regarded him as Tottenham's greatest ever PL striker. And I think it's almost a shame that he had to rupture his time at the Lane with his ill-fated move to Liverpool. His form never really recovered, and I think he could have gone on to achieve even greater things had he have stayed. In the middle of that 4-3 is Harry Kane. In my opinion, undoubtedly Tottenham's greatest ever Premier League striker, with 110 league goals in only 154 appearances. And he has been named to the last four PFA teams of the year. He's won two Premier League Golden Boots, and he's won this year's Golden Boot at the World Cup as England captain. I don't think there's much more I can say that'll do him justice. He's just a class act. And finally, Teddy Sheringham, who, like Keane, had two spells at Spurs, with the second one being a little less favourable than the first. But either way, winner of the Premier League's first ever Golden Boot at Spurs, the league's joint 10th top goalscorer of all time, a truly top player. And much like Modric and Bale, his move to a bigger club, in his case of course Manchester United, was in my opinion indicative of how good he was for them, particularly in his first spell and when he returned, having won the treble and three league titles in three seasons. He returned as a prodigal son. So just round off that team then, so in goal Hugo Lloris. In defence, we've got a centre-back three of Sol Campbell, Gary Mabbutt and Ledley King. In midfield, David Ginola, Darren Anderton, Luka Modric and Gareth Bale. And up front, Robbie Keane, Harry Kane and Teddy Sheringham. And as it's a true testament to the quality of that Spurs side that players such as Jurgen Klinsmann and Jermaine Defoe were left out. And we've had a few comments actually come through about that in the last few hours. So on Instagram, joe.wedder_18 asked, why is there a snake playing at centre-back? I assume he means Sol Campbell. Well, I explained that he, despite the controversy, for want of a better word, that surrounded his move to Arsenal, he was still a top player. And he was a good defender, and he could score good goals as well. I remember he scored, I think it was a brace against Manchester United in 98 or 99. Captained them to the League Cup. So, I think it would have been unfair if, due to his Arsenal links, I had left him out. So I had to keep him in, really. And Big Lad Greg said Jimmy Greaves with two question marks. Now, someone should probably tell Big Lad Greg that Jimmy Greaves actually retired 12 years before the Premier League was even founded. And left Spurs 10 years before that. So quite how he'd be expected to fit in a Spurs all-time Premier League 11 seems rather odd, but maybe that's just me. And on Twitter, Mike Cook 4 said, "You've got Mr. Ego in defence and Sick Note in midfield." Yes, Mike Cook 4. Yes, I have. So next week, I'm going to be doing a French Premier League 11 in keeping with my recent move to Lyon. So send me in your suggestions for that by next Friday, please. Anyway, moving on. So helping me continue my quest for football analysis superstardom is Chris Young with You Do The Talking, which leads us on to topic number 3.
Got you cranked up loud, getting pumped for the night. But when we pull in our drive, gonna turn you down quiet. I'll have one arm around her, one on the wheel. Hey, radio, let's make a deal.
SolihullRadio.com.
Chris Young there with You Do The Talking, which provides the basis for our next topic, which is whether good players make good captains. Now this is of course in light of Neymar being named as Brazil's new captain. Now I'm just curious as to what the credentials are these days for being named captain of your club. So for example, certainly in my generation, when I was growing up, primarily the early 2000s, we had Roy Keane at Manchester United, Steven Gerrard at Liverpool, John Terry at Chelsea, Patrick Vieira, Tony Adams at Arsenal, and then later on, Gary Neville then was at Manchester United. Nowadays, obviously since Ferguson retired, United have had Wayne Rooney, Michael Carrick, Antonio Valencia. You know, Chelsea brought in Gary Cahill after John Terry left. Arsenal recently named Laurent Koscielny as their new captain. So I'm just a bit, I don't know quite where I am. I don't quite know where clubs are in terms of where they're going and naming their captains. Because for me, a captain isn't about leading by example on the pitch, which therefore, if you like, gives the answer no to the question, do good players make good captains? Because for me, a captain's about being a leader, and I don't think you have to be the most naturally gifted on the pitch in order to be the best leader on the pitch. You know, I don't think you have to be able to do five step overs and sprint from one side of the pitch to the other in half a minute in order to be encouraging and criticising and be able to galvanise the rest of your team to grind out the result at the end of the game in the dying embers of the game. And for me, that's why a character like Lionel Messi, for example, is a useless captain. I think it was after, was it Copa America or some international tournament? He not only quit the national team as captain, he quit the national team altogether. Is that the hallmark of a leader? Is that the hallmark of a captain that's going to be encouraging his teammates on and off the pitch? Is that the hallmark of a player, of a man that is going to steer you to glory? In my opinion, no. Not in the slightest. And if you contrast that with Cristiano Ronaldo, I think he makes a good captain, not because he is the best player that's ever lived. I think he makes a good captain because of what we saw in the Euro 2016 final. Now, many people, certainly in this modern era, would have been whining and self-pitying having been taken off injured in the final. But Ronaldo took it upon himself to be on the touchline, essentially acting as the manager, maybe in some cases doing what the manager should have been doing. And was, I don't even know what he was doing. It was just incredible watching the animation he had on the touchline to get the rest of his teammates over that line and to get them to win that trophy. And for me, I think players take far more from a character like Ronaldo, who, yes, he might have this, I guess, diva persona, if you like. And I'll come on to someone else that certainly possesses that in a moment. But certainly from Ronaldo's point of view, it was the passion that he displayed on that touchline. I think that's the key component, really, for captain, is passion. Contrast that with, as I said, Neymar, who spends more time running around on the floor than he actually does doing anything decent. And I honestly think he is the most overrated player currently in world football. I just don't get it. I think natural talent isn't enough. And for the amount of issues that he is displaying, you know, I don't see how in any capacity rolling around on the floor pretending that you've just had your leg broken and all you've done is trip over a blade of grass, I don't see how that is going to then rub off onto the rest of his teammates in order to inspire them to victory. You know, it's just going to make them think you're an absolute moron. There's no way in God's earth we're going to be emulating you. I don't want this to be confused with leading by example in terms of good conduct. I think the two are different. The main sticking point with Roy Keane, as opposed to whether he was a good captain, was the amount of red cards that he received throughout his career and the aggression that he displayed. But in my opinion, it is the aggression and the passion that make him such a good captain and that made him such a good captain, particularly when we contrast it with players in the current footballing climate. Because would you ever imagine Neymar sacrificing himself for a place in the final of the Champions League in order to get his team into the final like Roy Keane did? I don't think he would. And I think that's where the difference is. Yes, Roy Keane was probably the most aggressive figure ever to grace football. Yes, he made some ridiculous errors, you know, throwing a ball at Alan Shearer, essentially ending Alf Ingerhorland's career. You know, some of these incidents in themselves probably would be indicative of a thug, if for want of a better word. But the crux of it is that he was a team player. He wasn't on that pitch for himself. And I think in the modern era, a lot of these standout superstars are very much individuals. I think if you'd put Lionel Messi in a different squad, which didn't have the same familial philosophy as Barcelona does, I think he would also be renowned for having that philosophy. Because look what happened with Argentina. Given how good he is, is it in Argentina's best interest that he steps down? Or was it in his best interest that he stood down? I'm going to go for the latter. And I think one of very few, if any, captains in the modern era that even come close to the Roy Keane-esque figure is Sergio Ramos at Real Madrid. Now, I know any Liverpool fans listening won't want to hear that, but I guarantee you, if you had him in, as captain of your team, you would absolutely adore him. He would go on to be one of your club's biggest ever legends. That is the kind of impact he has as captain of Real Madrid. And that's not because he is an outstanding two-footed performing step overs at 90 miles an hour play. That's not the kind of player he is. He's a very, I guess, robust, if you like. He is the kind of doesn't take any nonsense. He gets the job done. And he is a great leader because he inspires his team to victory. He almost, again, like the Roy Keane figure would, no matter who you're playing against, and Gary Neville also had this philosophy to an extent, doesn't matter who you're playing against, they are the opposition, they're the enemy. If you're friends internationally, it doesn't matter. As soon as you step onto that pitch and you're in different coloured shirts, you're enemies, you're rivals. And I think that's the big thing that makes a captain, is that you not only inspire in the way that you lead, but also in the way that you galvanise the team to, but also how he inspired the team with passion. And if you take Steven Gerrard again, for example, okay, yes, very talented player, but he was really Mr. Liverpool. If you, certainly players from my generation, perhaps it's different for people of an older generation, but certainly for me, if someone says, do you name a legendary Liverpool player, the first player that will immediately spring to mind for 99% of people will be Steven Gerrard. You know, he virtually single-handedly helped Liverpool overturn deficits in the 2005 Champions League final and the 2006 FA Cup final. But that wasn't just because of his goals, even though he did score in both, and including that absolutely emphatic winner in the FA Cup final, but it was more his ability to influence his teammates, to push for the equaliser, to push for the win. And you can see every time he put on that Liverpool shirt that he loved Liverpool Football Club with every fibre of his being. You saw what it meant to him to represent that club. It was more than a job. It was, I guess, more than a vocation. It was about leading an entire city, not just a club. And I think that was, and I think he relished having that weight on his shoulders. John Terry, likewise. I mean, Martin Tyler called him Mr. Chelsea when he stepped up to take the infamous 2008 Champions League final penalty that would have put the trophy in his hands. But enough about my happy reminiscing about his slip. But it was more because the reason that he was called Mr. Chelsea, and I imagine maybe the reason why they wanted him to take the final penalty that would have, had he scored it, put the trophy into his hands, was because of everything that he was as a captain, everything that he represented as a captain. To a lesser extent, the more aggressive Roy Keane, and perhaps more of the Steven Gerrard, just more encouragement than aggression. But even so, these are credentials that make great captains. And when we look back on the list of great captains from the 2000s and the 2010s, we're not going to be talking about Cristiano Ronaldo, Lionel Messi, or Neymar. We're going to be talking about Roy Keane, Patrick Vieira, and I'll talk about Vieira in more detail in a second, about Steven Gerrard and John Terry. And bearing in mind, maybe Gerrard to a lesser extent, but certainly Roy Keane, John Terry, and I guess maybe also Patrick Vieira, then they weren't the most technically gifted players. They weren't going to do five step overs and whack in a screamer from 40 yards. That wasn't their style of play, because they're not flair players. But it was almost what didn't make them a flair player that made them a great captain. And that's why I think it's difficult to balance the two. Patrick Vieira again, you know, the sworn enemy of Roy Keane. The way that winning was just, it was the be all and end all. And it wasn't a case of whether he was the one scoring the winner. It wasn't the case of whether he was the one that provided the amazing assist. It was about a team effort. And it was about him being the nucleus of that team on the pitch, which is what a captain should be doing. And that is also partly why I take issue with strikers being captains, and goalkeepers as well. I think it has to be someone kind of from the back to middle of the park, because you need to be able to effect influence during the game on the entire team. And I don't see how a goalkeeper can affect influence on a striker, and I don't see how a striker can affect influence on anyone behind him. And that's why Harry Kane, undoubtedly the best English striker of recent times, but even so, I don't think that he displayed much leadership on the pitch in the World Cup. Now, please feel free to correct me on that if I've totally got this wrong, but I certainly, to my mind, cannot think of a single time when on the pitch, and the emphasis is on the pitch, he was displaying leadership qualities. In fact, he was so quiet in our last couple of games, in the quarter-final and semi-final, he would make a dumb person look loud. So, I also think that being a captain, you need to have had experience. There are some exceptional cases, for example, Steven Gerrard, the immediate one that springs to mind. But I do think you need to have been there, done it, got the ripped shirt, in order to appreciate what it takes to be a leader. Which is also why I have a problem with Neymar being captain. Another reason why I have a problem with Neymar being named captain of Brazil is because, what has he really achieved in his career? You know, what is Neymar actually known for? For me, he's known for being the guy that quit Barcelona to join PSG for more money and because he could be the standout player at PSG. Not because he is one of the world's most talented players, which he is, but that's not why certainly I recognise him. That's certainly not how I think of him as a player nowadays. So, you know, has he had to work with the team to grind out a result in the desperate moments of the game? Has he had to show a strength in character and a resilience, both on and off the pitch, in order to inspire the rest of his teammates to go to push for glory? No, he hasn't. So, please, someone tell me, what has Neymar done in order to warrant being named Brazil captain? I just don't understand. I just do not understand where they are coming from. It just makes no sense to me. I mean, Brazil had a lukewarm World Cup at best. He only actually won trophies in France with PSG because there's really only one team in the league. So, again, credentials of a top player, of a top captain. Again, credentials of a top captain. I just don't buy it. I'm sorry. I just do not buy it. But that's enough about me raging on about why I don't really like Neymar and why I don't think he makes a great captain. It is, of course, now time for Winners and Sinners. This week's winners are Liverpool and Scotland defender Andrew Robertson and PSG and Brazil's Neymar, both of whom were named as their national team's new captain. David Beckham, who launched his brand new USA franchise, Club Internacional de Futbol Miami, or Inter Miami for short. Ronaldo Luis Nazario de Lima, otherwise known as the Brazilian Ronaldo, or Fat Ronaldo, who became the majority owner of La Liga club Real Valladolid after buying 51% of the club's shares, making him the first former footballer to become the owner of a European top-flight club. Javi Gracia, who was named the Premier League Manager of the Month for August. And I can't help but feel that the Premier League heard me arguing the case for Gracia to win on last week's show. And Lucas Moura, who was named the Premier League's Player of the Month. And this week's sinners include Mario Lemina, who was the recipient of the UK's biggest ever speeding fine of £96,000, which isn't even 2 weeks' wages for the Southampton defender. Guinea international and former Derby County forward Abdul Kamara, who has been forced to retire due to a heart condition, aged just 28. Marcus Rashford, who literally saw red after headbutting former United man Phil Bardsley in the Red Devils' 2-0 defeat of Burnley. Michael Collins, who was sacked by Bradford after just 7 games in charge. And finally, Mexican second division side Dorados de Sinaloa, who have named Diego Maradona as their new manager. Although that said, the two do have similarities. For example, Dorados are struggling to move up the table, and Diego Maradona struggles to move unaided. And that was this week's Winners and Sinners. Moving on now to a brand new segment on the Josh Samuel Show, which is a look back at the Fantasy League. So I have set up a Fantasy League for the Josh Samuel Show, like the World Cup one, on the Fantasy iTeam app. And I've drafted in a new correspondent called Matt, who is going to be... I'll be chatting with him every week, just seeing what's going on, who's had a good week, who's had a bad week, which players have scored the most points, which players probably should have been avoided and being left into their teams. So usually I'll be chatting with him about the Fantasy League, but for this week only, he has recorded just himself, just speaking about the Fantasy League. So without any further ado, I'm going to hand you in the very capable hands of Matt.
Welcome to this new segment. My name is Matt and I'll be rounding up the fantasy football that's been going on in the mini league. This is a round that I used to do on my YouTube channel, and Josh liked this enough to ask me to do the same on his radio show, and I shall be doing here. So I'll be talking about two teams this time. Firstly, Josh Samuels, whose team is carry us over the finish line. So in his goalkeeper was Kepa, from Chelsea, kept a clean sheet, 7 points. Defenders, he had 5, James Tarkowski and Ben Mee, no points after conceding 2 against Man United. Chelsea and Cesar Azpilicueta both picked up 7 points after the clean sheet. Marcus Alonso, an assist and a clean sheet against Bournemouth means he got 10 points. Kwong Mata, he didn't play, so that's no points. Paul Pogba missed a penalty against Burnley, so that's -1. Raheem Sterling, 8 points after his goal. Romelu Lukaku was the captain, so after his 2 goals, giving him 12 points, the captain times 2 means he has 24, and Harry Kane got 2 points. Defenders, Trent Alexander-Arnold, 1 point. Andrew Robertson, 4 points. And Virgil van Dijk, 1 point. They were all in this team, but they were scheduled out for transfers by the Chelsea defenders. And Josh Tuch's roundups means he got 70 points and 285 points in total. Next, we have my team, Bristol's Hearty Pirates. And so picked up 43 points. And in goal, I had David De Gea, clean sheet and 2 saves, meaning 8 points. Patrick Van Aanholt conceded twice against Southampton, so 0 points. Benjamin Mendy, an assist but no clean sheet, 4 points against Newcastle. Andrew Robertson did the same against Leicester, no clean sheet, but he got an assist, so 4 points. Henrik Mkhitaryan came off the bench for Arsenal but did no more, so that's just 1 point. Christian Eriksen, 2 points. Ryan Fraser, 2 points. Ryan Sessegnon, 1 point. Sergio Aguero, my captain, got an assist but no goal, so 5 points, but the captain means I've got 10 points, gained 10 points from him. Harry Kane, 2 points, and Mitrovic scored against Brighton, so that's 7 points. And my scheduled transfers, I did one beforehand where I brought Mitrovic in for Sane, and I scheduled in Mkhitaryan for Ruben Neves, having picked up 2 points early. Oh yeah, so the table is in first with 285 points, Josh, 285 points. Second, me, Bristol's Hearty Pirates, managed 186 points. Three, Spiders Return, managed by Peter Parker, 183 points. In fourth, we've got He Shoots, He Scores FC, who got 175 points. In fifth place, Beston Hurst, 159 points. In sixth place, Evertoni FC, managed by Tony Samuels, who finished second in Manager of the Week, and a total of 100. He got 54 points, having got 49 in the weekend. Seventh place, we got Celtic Lizards, managed by Rich Poole. He got 144 points. In 8th place, We Aren't the Champions, managed by Jeff Townsend, 143 points. In 9th, Smithy's Snakes, managed by Jim Smith, 136. 10th place, Chicken Tikka Mo Salah, managed by Lee Stonewall on 128 points. And Hajduk Banana Split, managed by Paul Long, 118 points. So that was the roundup of this weekend. If you like your team, me to cover your team, if you're in this league, then contact Josh or myself at MattsAttack9 and I'll see what I can do for you.
Thank you very much, Matt, for that wonderful look back on the last week in the Josh Samuel Show's Fantasy iTeam League. That's a little glimpse of what is to come over the next weeks and months, and I'm delighted to have recruited my very first correspondent. So welcome to the team to you, Matt. Anyway, it's time now to discuss how accurate EA Sports FIFA ratings are. But first, here's a bit of Paolo Nutini with 10 out of 10. Nicely into our penultimate topic of the afternoon, which is the question of how accurate FIFA 19's and FIFA games in general, their ratings really are. And this is simply coming in light of the fact that they're starting to drip feed us the ratings of the top 100 rated players. I believe at the time of speaking we're up to the top 60 or something like that. So for me, the problem is that this season's players are rated using last season's performances. Now, I'll admit to you, I don't have an immediate way past that. But the reason I take issue with it is thus. So we all know that the 2015-16 season saw Leicester City win the Premier League title. If Jamie Vardy, perhaps fairly so, kicked off that season with a 75 rating. Now, to put that into some context for those of you that don't know the first thing about FIFA, apart from how to spell it, is that So players on the online version of FIFA called a FIFA Ultimate Team are classified into bronze, which I believe goes up to 64, silver, which is 65 to 74, and gold, which is 75 onwards. Now, and for some more context, so the best players like Cristiano Ronaldo are rated, I believe he's 94 at the moment, and he's the highest rated player out of 99, which is the maximum. Now, Jamie Vardy was, to my mind, undoubtedly, perhaps, Riyad Mahrez aside, the best player in the Premier League that season, bar none. Bar none. Now, with Chelsea finishing, what was it? Was it 10th in the end in that season? And with their so-called best players like Eden Hazard and Willian and the like, all scoring massive ratings that season and the season that followed, I'm just curious as to the extent to which these ratings accurately reflect the previous season and how they are meant to accurately reflect the current season. Because I struggle to see how a player who scored 4 goals in 31 league games in 2015-16, that is Eden Hazard, can get an 88 rating. But Jamie Vardy, who scored 24 goals in 36 appearances, only gets an 82 rating. Now, maybe someone can enlighten me on how this works, but to my mind, if you're rating players based on their performances from last season, then I don't see how a player that scored 4 goals in 31 appearances can have a rating which is 6 points better than a player that scored 24 goals in 36 appearances, won the league, and broke the Premier League record for most consecutive games that he scored in. I'm just confused. Totally bewildered by this. Is this an accurate representation of the Premier League? Is it really? If that's the way that they're going to go? Now, don't get me wrong, Eden Hazard is a better player than Jamie Vardy, because that was then proven the following season when Chelsea won the Premier League again. And I think Hazard scored around 15, 16 goals, something like that, in that season. I'm not sure if he played the full amount of games. But it's the logic that EA Sports uses to get to these ratings that I find slightly dubious. And I was actually, in preparation for talking to you about this afternoon, I took the liberty of just reading a few articles about this, and I noticed that one article stated that had some information from a former EA data collector who revealed, I think this is going back to 2016, that some players could be given ratings by people who have not even seen them play. So that's to say, it's very possible that some random bloke in God knows where has just been presented with the names Eden Hazard, Jamie Vardy, knows that Eden Hazard's quite good, knows that Jamie Vardy used to play for Fleetwood, and has given Jamie Vardy an 82 rating for FIFA 17, and Eden Hazard an 88 rating for FIFA 17. And the same collector says that there is no official training or screening process in order to become a data collector for EA Sports, with senior data collectors even being able to overrule rating suggestions without any evidence. Wow. Just wow. How is this possible? How can EA Sports expect people to pay in excess of £50 for a game that is meant to accurately reflect contemporary football, but is being updated by people that probably don't even have to spell football, let alone understand it. It is just utter nonsense. And also in 2016, an EA program lead, Michael Miller-Murring, told ESPN that they even guessed a little bit regarding some player ratings, adding that the scale of this guesswork is far greater than previously thought. Again, just wow. And to go back to another comparison, Falcao, who is notorious for being one of the worst Premier League signings of all time in terms of the nature of the big signing when he first arrived, compared to, you know, the flop that he left 2 years later. Now, he arrived to the Premier League in FIFA 15 with an 88 rating, making him one of the best strikers in the game. So his 4 goals and 26 league appearances for Manchester United meant that he dropped 5 points to 83 in FIFA 16. Now, if we're going to compare, let's just forget how many points he dropped down by for a second. So let's compare Falcao with Jamie Vardy. So Falcao, 83 rated, 4 goals in 26 league appearances. Jamie Vardy, 82 rated, with 24 goals in 36 appearances, and the Premier League title, and breaking Premier League records in the process. Where is the logic in that? I just do not understand this. Just do not understand how someone can generally sit there and honestly, without laughing, say that Falcao scoring 4 goals in 26 league appearances makes him statistically better than Jamie Vardy, who scored 24 goals in 36 games and defying all expectations beyond belief. I'm just so confused by this. And it does not show any signs of slowing down. Because there's also, of course, the bias of their cover stars being given more generous ratings than perhaps they should. Of course, when Messi was the cover star, he was the top-rated player. And since he and the rest of Barcelona defected to PES, Pro Evolution Soccer, Ronaldo becomes the cover star, then Ronaldo becomes the best-rated player, when really he should have been there all along. Whether EA Sports going to go with this, I don't know. But also, in terms of Cristiano Ronaldo being 5 points off the best rating you can get, and never having reached that, I am therefore a bit unsure as to what qualifies you to reach the maximum. If we're saying that he's the greatest player that's ever been, how does he improve on essentially perfection? And being 94 rated out of 99, being some way off perfection. Again, I think this is almost like a reality show-esque approach that they've taken, where they are tailoring and altering reality in order to appease their own financial, economical, commercial gains. And for me, that then detracts from the enjoyment for the player. And I do know that people are starting to defect from FIFA for a more realistic gameplay, or even altogether, because first and foremost, it's a game that should be for the fans. And I think slowly but surely, people are beginning to think that all they're interested in is really lining their own pockets. And that's evident by the way in which they don't really care about their player ratings. They don't want them to be accurate. They don't really care if they're accurate, as long as they have a number next to a player and it roughly reflects their ability from maybe 3 years ago. That's all they're bothered about. And I think it's a real shame, because certainly when I was growing up with the FIFA's 04, 05, 06, the ratings were a lot more realistic, and we were getting players getting nearer to the maximum rating, because I do think that there are players worthy of that maximum rating. But anyway, another of my characteristic rants over with. I think it's time for the adverts.
Fed up with condensation every morning and hate that yucky mold patch in the bathroom? It's time to contact EnviroVent. They've helped tackle mold and condensation dampness in over a million homes, just like yours. To find out more and to book a free home survey, visit EnviroVent.com, because air matters.
Solihullradio.com.
Stagecoach Solihull teaches skills
in drama, singing and dance.
But these skills don't just vanish when the curtain falls.
They're skills for life, stretching imaginations and improving literacy.
For a career in the arts,
learning new skills,
or just having fun.
So visit our website,
www.stagecoach.co.uk/Solihull.
Stagecoach Solihull, skills for the arts.
Skills for life.
Yeah!
The Fireplace and Stove Centre, 1204 Stratford Road, Hall Green. Specialists in wood-burning stoves, gas and electric fires, with over 50 live displays in the showroom. Come in and experience your new fireplace solutions. Call 0121 777 8585 for more details.
You're listening to Solihull Radio.
Indian Dream on Dovehouse Parade, Solihull's premier family-run restaurant offering authentic Indian and Bangladeshi cuisine with fresh ingredients and creative chefs. They can provide bespoke dining experiences, eat in or take away. 0121 704 9058.
Wilson there with our final topical song of the afternoon with Your Love Keeps Lifting Me Higher and Higher. Something else that keeps being lifted higher and higher is the modern day equivalent of the biggest Premier League transfers of all time. So there was a website, I'm not overly sure which website it was, but a website released a starting 11 and I believe a subbench as well of how a starting 11 would look, almost topical team sheet like, if you like. And so it gave their original price tag and also how much they would be worth in today's money. So kind of in topical team sheet style, I'm going to go through the starting 11 and then basically say whether I think they're worthy of being in that team or not. So in goal, Kepa Arrizabalaga, signed for £71 million, of course, only this summer, hasn't changed. So, do I think he's worth being the most expensive goalkeeper in the world? No, not based on what we've seen so far. I mean, he's okay, but I think he's got a long way to go before he justifies that price tag. So, I would probably argue that someone like David De Gea, who I believe is on the subs bench, I think, yeah, I've got it up now, yeah. So he was signed for around £21 million, and in today's money he'd be worth about £62 million. So, in my opinion, that would be more worthy, but of course, you can't inflate today's money today. So Kepa Arrizabalaga there in goal. At right back is Paolo Ferreira. Now, Paolo Ferreira was signed by Chelsea as well, from Porto for £13.6 million in 2004, which, with inflation, rises to £60 million today. Now, again, I'm not overly sure he's worthy of being the most valuable defender, most valuable right-back, rather, in the Premier League. I'm sure that within a few years, Kyle Walker, with his £50 million from last summer, that will surely surpass that. Ferreira was a good servant for Chelsea for a number of years, don't get me wrong, but I don't think he was that good. I don't think he was good enough to warrant being the most expensive, to warrant the modern-day contemporary inflated price tag. So, not too much to say really about Paolo Ferreira. Rio Ferdinand, the first of the centre-backs. Now, he is someone I would 100% back to be the most valuable centre-back with inflation in the Premier League. United, of course, only paying, it seems like a small amount these days, £29 million. But, of course, it was 16 years ago, inflated to £125 million, broke the record for a defender back in the day. But, of course, potentially the best value-for-money purchase of a defender in the Premier League era, getting 12 trophies in his, I think, 13-odd seasons at Manchester United. Brilliant, brilliant signing there by Sir Alex Ferguson. And, of course, from rivals Leeds United, only spent, I think, just over a year there. So, if you're talking about when a player justifies the price tag, without question, Rio Ferdinand. And I think that's where Liverpool have tried to go with Virgil van Dijk. And I do think that the kind of equivalent of spending £70 million or whatever it was, £75 million on a centre-back like they did with Virgil van Dijk is kind of where they're going. But the difference is I just don't think they're going to get the trophies to back that up. So if we're looking at the same thing in 10, 15 years' time, and Virgil van Dijk is up there alongside Rio Ferdinand, I don't believe that we'll be sitting there thinking that his was as justified as Rio Ferdinand's, based primarily on the trophies that he will or won't have won. Alongside Ferdinand at centre-back is Ricardo Carvalho, the third Chelsea player to feature out of four so far, also like Ferreira, moving from Porto. Now, he was bought by Jose Mourinho for £20.4 million, which equates today to £90 million. Now, again, I don't think that he was good enough to warrant being nowadays in the most expensive team sheet from the Premier League era with inflation. Yes, he was good alongside John Terry. Yes, he won, I think, was it three Premier League titles? But I don't think people will look back and put him in the top 10 best centre-backs of all time. I honestly don't. So, yeah, I'm not overly convinced by Ricardo Carvalho. Left-back, now this is the one that shocked me the most. Graham Lasso, who was signed also by Chelsea, the fourth out of five, from Blackburn in 1997, for £7 million, which these days is £74 million. Wow. I just couldn't imagine him being worth that much. Yeah, he was good at Blackburn. He won the league with them. But was he worth that much? And would he be worth that much these days if he was still playing? In my opinion, I don't think so. Yeah, he was decent when Abramovich first took over. But you know, there's a reason that they brought in bigger and better players, and that's because he was, in my opinion, bank average at best. There's a centre midfield three, kicking off with, can you guess which team this one's from? Yeah, you guessed it, Chelsea. Mikel Essien from Lyon to Chelsea in 2005. So the Ghanaian signed for £25.8 million back in 2000, all those 13 years ago, and today that equates to £116 million. Wow. But I, to be honest, he's one of the players that I think justified the price tag at the time. But I don't think that it would justify £116 million in this day and age, when you think that the players, kind of like the Kylian Mbappes of this world, are going for only a bit more, and Philippe Coutinho. I don't think Mikel Essien is anywhere near in that calibre. So, probably not as fair a price tag, if I'm brutally honest about that. Alongside him in the centre of midfield is Juan Sebastian Veron, arguably the greatest flop of the Premier League era, maybe just behind another one, which is yet to come, also an Argentinian heading to Manchester United. Now, Sir Alex Ferguson broke the British transfer record when he spent £26.4 million on the Argentinian from Lazio, which comes to £116 million, just like Mikel Essien. Now, I've read some articles which have said that Veron is not an outright flop, but I would argue that he is. If you only spend 2 years at a club that has broken the British transfer record to sign you, chances are you flopped. And even when he went on to Chelsea, it got even worse, didn't it? So, Juan Sebastian Veron, probably so far the least deserving of a place in this team sheet. Ah, now another contemporary one. The final centre midfielder, Paul Pogba, who rejoined Manchester United from Italian champions Juventus 2 summers ago. Now, it's almost one of those, it's almost the prodigal son kind of story, isn't it? Where he has a few problems, leaves, comes back a little while later, or 4 years later. United broke the world record to sign him for £89 million, which only rises marginally, comparatively speaking, to £118 million. So, quite a big rise, really, in the last 2 years. Surely with Neymar's record-breaking transfer for, £200 million to PSG, causing the knock-on effect there. Does he justify his price tag? You know, with £118 million in this day and age, no, I don't think he does. If I'm honest with you, I don't think that what he's produced for Manchester United so far justifies the price tag in the slightest. And I think maybe inflated to £89 million would have been more realistic. So, third United player in a row on the right of the forwards, Angel Di Maria, the Champions League final man of the match from 2014, arrived at Old Trafford, another British record signing for £61 million, which comes to £100 million exactly in today's money. And, well, who knows what happened there. He was meant to be the marquee signing for Louis van Gaal. Didn't quite settle, didn't quite fit into the LVG philosophy, as many players didn't. And he left for PSG only a year later. It seems that there's a beginning to be a bit of a running theme with players that haven't quite justified their price tags and flopped. And I think Angel Di Maria certainly falls into that. On the left of the forwards, Robinho, arguably the most notorious flop, simply because he was destined for Chelsea. Man City swooped in with their new Arab owners at the last second, brought him in, and, well, the rest is history. He didn't quite justify the fee that they paid for him. And I mean, hilariously, he thought he was actually joining Manchester United, which I think says it all about the whole saga. He had a few decent-ish moments, a couple of good goals, but never really looked like he was going to justify the £34 million that Man City paid Real Madrid for him in 2009. And that does equate to £91 million in today's money. I don't want to keep repeating myself with using the same phrases, but doesn't justify the price tag. Didn't then, certainly doesn't now. And finally, Andrei Shevchenko, who joined Chelsea from AC Milan in 2006 for £29.4 million, which comes today to £144 million. But he could never quite compete with Didier Drogba, who was the talisman for Chelsea for a number of years at Stamford Bridge, and his career never really picked up again after leaving Chelsea, or even after joining Chelsea. A couple of standout moments, but nothing too much to write home about. So, Andrei Shevchenko there, rounding off the 11. And the bench, made up by David De Gea, who, as I said, I think would be more worthy of a place in that side. Yap Stam, when he moved also to Manchester United from PSV Eindhoven in 1998, worth £74 million in today's money compared to his £11.3 million. of course, leaving Old Trafford 3 years later, in questionable circumstances to say the least. Roy Keane, whose £5.7 million launch is up to £113 million. And as I mentioned earlier on in the show, in my opinion, the greatest captain ever. Period. Not even just in the Premier League, ever. And up front, there's Alan Shearer and Didier Drogba. Alan Shearer there from his move from Blackburn to Newcastle in 1996. When they broke the world record, £15 million they spent on him, which goes to £142 million today. And Didier Drogba, finally, Marseille to Chelsea 2004, £26.2 million, equivalent to £116 million, of course, winning the Champions League for Chelsea with that penalty. So I would probably argue that some of those would be more worthy of a place in that team. But nonetheless, interesting to see how players tend not to justify their transfer fees. We'll obviously see Chelsea's goalkeeper Kepa Arrizabalaga certainly has to prove himself, but you know, Paulo Ferreira, Ricardo Carvalho, Graham Lasso, Juan Sebastian Veron, Angel Di Maria, Robinho, Andrei Shevchenko, more than half of those players not going on to justify their price tags. Paul Pogba, again, probably still has some way to go before he can justify it. So it's not really a debate topic, because obviously I can't interact with any of you this week because I'm in Lyon, as I said. But if you have any thoughts on that, please feel free to tweet me at Samuels Radio, or you can tweet the station at Solihull_radio, or if you want to email, text. The rest of the details are on, of course, the Solihull Radio website. Well, anyway, that rounds off another fine week of football chat and banter on Solihull Radio's only sports show. Please return to us in an hour's time, where the wonderful Debs Donnelly will be delightfully serenading you all with our usual mad mixture of chat, talk, laughter and music. It might be a bit of a quiet week for me this week, with, of course, the UEFA Nations League having already kicked off, so I'm probably going to be launching into a bit of that. And, of course, we've got our topical team sheet. So, as I said, next week is going to be a French Premier League-themed topical team sheet, so the best 11 players to have played in the Premier League, and we're also going to be resuming our correspondence with our brand new fantasy I-team correspondent Matt, so we'll have more from him next week, and of course much more. But until then, I'll be here same place, same time, as always, 3 till 5 on Solihull Radio. I'm Josh Samuels, this is the Josh Samuels Show on Solihull Radio. Until then, it's 5 o'clock somewhere.
Getting paid by the hour and older by the minute. My boss just pushed me over the limit. I'd like to call him something. I think I'll just call it a day. Pour me something tall and strong. Make it a hurricane before I go insane. It's only 12:30, but I don't care. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. This lunch break is gonna take all afternoon and half the night. Tomorrow morning I know there'll be hell to pay. Hey, but that's alright. I ain't had a day off now in over a year. My Jamaican vacation's gonna start right here. If the phone's for me, you can tell them I just sailed away. And pour me something tall and strong. Make it a hurricane before I go insane. It's only 12:30, but I don't care. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. My tab
Buffett do?
Funny you should ask, Alan. I'd say home is something tall and strong. Make it a hurricane before I go insane. It's only 12:30, but I don't care.
Man. It doesn't matter. It's 5 o'clock somewhere.
It's always on 5 in Margaritaville, come to think of it.
Yeah, I heard it did.
You've been there, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
I've seen your boat there.
I've been to Margaritaville a few times.
All right. Well, that's good.
Stumble all the way back.
Okay. We just want to make sure you can keep it between the navigational beacons.
Between the buoys. I got it.
All right. Well, it's 5 o'clock. Let's go somewhere.
I'm ready. Crank it up.
Let's get out of here.
I'm gone.